pop, you can drink my semen.
Release the brainstorm to make your motherfucking brain warm. A strange form, something kind of lyrical. Biggie the bastard, so that's kind of spiritual. Well, in God we trust, turns our butts, got that disgusting suicide thumping. And do you know where you're going to? Do you like the things that I bring?
On the 20th of December 2010, a Minecraft server named Two Builders Two Tools was set up by a group of friends, Housemaster and GeorgeBush420 being the notable ones that people still associate the server with running to this day, whilst in modern times it is known that neither of these accounts are involved in the server anymore, as whoever owned the Housemaster account has now changed its name to Xponged, which literally means to obliterate, and the account GeorgeBush420 is owned by a player called Duke Police. We have good reason to believe that back when the server was started, they created it together as two friends. Based on the construct of a Garry's Mod server that they had ran before this, the server offered complete freedom to say and do whatever a player may please. One of the only things that has stayed consistent throughout the almost 10-year long lifespan of the server. Another thing that has stayed consistent throughout the years is the complete and utter edgy retardation of the player base. So, as you can imagine, it's not really a surprise to find out that in the beginning of 2B2T, the server was mostly occupied by users of that lovely family-friendly internet community known as 4chan. Some estimates from the time say that 70% of the player base were 4chan users, however, I haven't found anything that backs up this claim, so take it with a grain of salt. The rest of the player base mainly came from sites like Reddit, Facepunch, and Something Awful. Since nobody really bothered to document anything back then, it takes a lot of digging to find a clear structure of events from the early days. However, from what I have seen, it basically goes along the lines of this. So, other than the fact that Spawn had already been basically fucked up, almost nothing is known about 2B2T in 2010, which is fair enough because the server was created right near the end of December, and so 2011 came round only a couple weeks after the server was first started. However, early 2011 is when shit really hit the fan. You see, at this point, 2B2T was basically just populated with 4chan users because the first advertisements by the admins of 2B2T were put onto 4chan. And it sort of became 4chan's Minecraft server of choice, obviously. And people usually get the misconception that these players were all one group. Well, this was never the case, however, it's easy to understand how people get this idea because when players from Facepunch were rallied up by a player named Cheshead and decided to start playing on the server to create a quote-unquote peaceful anarchy, the 4chaners weren't exactly too welcoming to this idea, and so this started what is most commonly known as the Facepunch 4chan War, and it was kind of like the Russia War but with way less people and not 12-year-olds. So these player bases were very toxic to one another, always trying to destroy one another's base, killing each other, and so on. If you want to get a full in-depth explanation of this war, then check out this video. He does a very good job of explaining all the details, and I'll drop a link to it in the description. However, what you really need to know is that Cheshead was the one who mainly organized the face punches and set up the bases. Unlike the 4chaners, the face punches actually had some sort of hierarchy system, which basically consisted of citizens, mayors, advisors, and a president. They also had many notable bases which are still talked about to this day. The biggest example of this is 2K2K, you know, that fucking hole near Spawn? Well, yeah, that was a base at one point. Although a lot of people think the base was at positive 2K2K, well, it was actually at negative 2K2K, so yeah, cool fact I guess. Other examples include Camp Facepunch, Fort Creationism Corner, Pittsburgh, the Dice Temple, all of which can still be visited as ruins to this day. The Facepunchers were also the ones to perform the first ever dupe as far as we know, which involved using two pistons and a simple redstone clock, which was very OP for duping diamond blocks and allowed the Facepunchers to amass a very decent bit of wealth on the server. Along with this dupe, 2B2T's first ever backdoor also occurred during this time period, when the player Popbob made a plugin for Housemaster which stopped people from getting stuck on the nether roof. It also allowed him and his friends to be able to use the Too Many Items mod, which could be used to spawn in literally any item or block in the game. Popbob and his friends made great use of this at a base appropriately named Plugin Town, where they had access to infinite building materials and apparently a lot of diamond blocks. They even tormented Housemaster by literally going to spawn and flying around him, while placing things like bedrock and ghast spawn eggs everywhere. Popob also used his access to be able to TP to any player he chose, and many bases fell as a result of this. Once players had got suspicious that Popob had some kind of TP access, they teamed up with Housemaster to make a fake base which they talked about in chat so that they could bait Popob there. Everyone's suspicions were finally confirmed when Housemaster literally watched Popob appear out of thin air at this base, therefore confirming that Popob had backdoored the server. The Facepunch 4chan war, which we just mentioned, kind of settled down in early 2012 as a lot of the Facepunch users decided to either go solo or just outright quit the server. This was also around the time where another group founded by the Judge Holden was rising in member count, named the Judges Group. Their base, named Revendale, had recently been destroyed, and so they packed up and moved to found a base further than any base had ever been on the server. After days of walking in the nether, they finally reached 1 million by 1 million, and set up their base, appropriately named 1 million base, just 6,000 blocks away from the Axis. They thought what they had done was so special that they started inviting many well-known and talented builders to the base that they considered elite. However, as we all know, you cannot simply hand out your cords on TBTT, and so when they invited a player named X0XP to the base, after staying for a few weeks without doing anything, he grabbed his TNT and blew the whole thing up. After this, near the end of 2012, Housemaster fully took control over the server as his friends probably lost interest, and he also bought the server several new SSDs to run on, which were pretty expensive for the time. The transfer process to this new hardware took around 3 months, and for this time the 2b2t players mainly played on a server called 2b2t.us, which was run by a friend of PoliceMike55, and this is one of the only existing screenshots viewable from when this temp server was running. Heading into 2013 now, nothing too special happened, some friends were made and some cool bases started popping up, however, there wasn't really all that much happening. That is, until Housemaster decided to put the server on a plugin testing map for a while. Whilst the server was running on this temp map, the players in the group called the Black Flag Group and the players in the group called the Hitlerwood Crew were like, wouldn't it be very epic if we could work together to build a big base? And this was going to go two ways. What was probably going to happen is both groups would build some cobble shacks, and then some autistic child would decide to break somebody else's shack, and that guy would be like, hey, why you grief my base, fuck you kid, and they'd never speak to each other ever again. However, this didn't actually happen, and in fact, the two groups really enjoyed basing together, and so they decided that they would unite on 2b2t itself and form a new group, which would of course be known as Valkyria. 2013 was also the year when the server was publicly backdoored for the second time. This time in December of 2013, it was backdoored by Pyrobyte and iTristan when they made a plugin for Housemaster that patched many of the illegal items from the time, like bedrock and spawn eggs. However, it also gave them access that allowed them to create some very interesting hacked items. By renaming any item to this exact string in an anvil, would give it a stat count of -1, which effectively meant it could be placed an unlimited amount of times. They did not, however, gain OP privileges from this specific backdoor, although iTristan and Pyrobyte did use this backdoor to their advantage to do things like teleport to the world border for the very first time on 2b2t, spawning ghast eggs, and help his Valkyrian friends to set up spawn bases and get geared during the second incursion. Which leads me directly onto the topic of course, the first incursions. So, in case you didn't already know what an incursion is, it's basically when a bunch of geared players launch a sudden attack on spawn, usually to try and reduce the server's new player population, but sometimes just because it's something to do. The very first incursion was started by a player named Hindi G-Day, and was mostly because he was bored. Whilst building at a base called Valkyria, he proposed the idea of invading spawn to his fellow basemates, and since the 1.4.7 dupe was still active, they would have access to unlimited gear, and so it was agreed that they would all march to spawn and begin. Sadly, I can't go into too much detail here as it will make the video way too long, but what you really gotta know is they ran around spawn for a bit, killing new players, then they decided to inhabit that Facepunch base 2k2k we talked about earlier. Even though it was in ruins, they fixed it up and also made supply farms all over spawn. However, spawn PvPers and griefers kept harassing the incursion by blowing up 2k2k even more and continuously killing them at spawn, and so yeah, it only lasted a week and in the end of it, it was pretty shit. Since it was only 2 months after the first one, I guess we will go straight on to talk about the second incursion, which is slightly more interesting as there was actually a reason behind it. So it all starts when a player named X0XP named a wonderful client called Adolf Client. However, it wasn't so wonderful because if you used it, it would go on to send all your coordinates directly to the creator. And of course, it only took a few Valkarians to download it for the majority of the group's bases to be compromised. All in all, they were pissed, and to add fuel to the fire, shortly after this, the popular gaming magazine IGN made an article on the 6 wonders of Minecraft, which I'll leave a link to in the description because it's pretty interesting. Anyway, in this article they cover 2B2T spawn, and this is pretty much the first taste 2B2T ever had of sudden exposure generated from the wider media. Of course, this led to a massive amount of new players joining the server, which, bear in mind, had never been seen before. Loads of these new players went and started setting up bases and farms at spawn, almost colonizing it. This, of course, made basically all the older players angry, and so, fueled by the rage of all their bases being destroyed, the Valkarians decided to take up arms with other players and take back spawn. The three main goals this achieved was destroying all new structures around spawn, killing every new player on site, and protecting XDC2's famous spawn base, NFE. They then went on to build their very own incursion base at spawn, which actually started out as a shitty dirt hut built by a player named Fubster. However, over time it expanded into a massive community project. Beacons and highways were built all over spawn, and this all lasted 2 months until everything finally went back to normal. All in all, it actually went well, and a lot of players had a lot of fun taking part. Anyway, let's move on from this, as I don't want this video to be an epic history of incursions. And that was pretty much an insanely summarized overview of the main events of 2013. However much 2013 was painted by the rise of the Valkarian Empire, 2014 saw it fall just as hard. A spiral of events triggered in January would quickly lead to the split up of the group into smaller sub-factions like the Legion of Shenandoah and the Gape Base Group. This, however, wasn't the end of Valkyria, because throughout the rest of the year it would slowly come back together and bases would be found, such as the Nova base, which was actually built on a temp server, and the Fenrir project, both of which helped rebuild friendships and ultimately, the group itself. Housemaster has left 2B2T forever and is no longer in charge. The server will continue like normal though, and will be operated by an anonymous friend. This message was posted to the official 2B2T website on July 31st, 2014, and to this day, nobody knows why or how this happened, because the identity of whoever runs the server has been one of the longest running unsolved mysteries to date, and honestly, I think the topic needs its own video dedicated to it, because there are so many plot holes and things that just don't add up, which won't fit into this video as it would involve a lot of speculation. This video is covering recorded history. Anyway, moving on. For now, all you really need to know is that straight after this message was posted to the website, the server owner's personality changed more to what we know today. However, this never really had too much of an impact on the server, as many players who were around at the time claimed that this message was just a weird joke by the server admin to troll the player base. This was actually around the time when Housemaster installed a plugin which patched the holes in the nether roof, as previously players were using them to walk and travel on top of the nether, which was obviously extremely OP. What House didn't know, however, is that this plugin had a bug that would also spawn a flat bedrock sheet at the bottom Y level of end chunks. So when a player would update a chunk in the end by placing a block or whatever, it would spawn this flat bedrock sheet at the bottom of the chunk, and players actually use this to their advantage to travel out to make end bases and such. What's cool though is that House never reverted this bedrock, and so you can go to the end to this day and see it for yourself what it looks like. Other than that, some guy called Thebes and Sound started work on a spawn river, which would later be known as the Southern Canal, which now stretches over 250,000 blocks out in the overworld, and yeah, that's about it to be honest. Really nothing all that massive happened in 2014, which could either be due to the fact that a lot of the people playing were friendly to each other and busy with building, or it could be that not much was documented from the time. I really don't know. Either way, 2015's gonna be pretty cool, so let's move on. Now that we are in the year 2015, we are going to again move back to the topic of Valkyria. I know you've probably had enough of it by now, but this is probably the last time I'm gonna mention it, so let's get going. After the server updated to 1.8 in January, lots of new building blocks and game mechanics were added to Minecraft. This caused the Valkarians to want to go out and make a fresh new base, and so they did. The now famous space Asgard 2 was founded in March of 2015, and it lasted just over a month until April of the same year when it was leaked and eventually destroyed. And what do Valkyrians do when they get triggered because their base gets griefed? Well, yup, you guessed it. Epic incursion time. The third incursion was one of the ones that actually went well, so let me explain. First up, they made an epic hypebeast base to flex all their emeralds on new fags. Then the famous monument Wrath Outpost was constructed using Pyrobyte's unlimited obsidian exploit, which I mentioned to you earlier. Popbob, Auramonger, and Drew Bookman, along with many other people, tried to grief and stop the incursion. However, they all ended up running away in combat logging, so yeah, that was an incredibly summarized explanation of what happens during the third incursion. In June of 2015, the team known as the Vortex Coalition, or VOCO for short, was founded, and these guys will play a big part in a lot of the history covered for the next few years, so make sure to remember their name. The next month in August, Project Vault was started, which aimed to preserve every 2B2T build and monument ever made, kinda like the 2B2T archive of today. Then, Vice made an article about the server, which, not gonna lie, is really interesting, so I'll link that in the description if I remember. If not, just Google Vice 2B2T and you'll probably find it. Motherboard actually also made another article in the same month, which is less interesting, but it still brought a fair few players to the server. December of 2015 saw the fall of ImpSpace, you know, that cool looking one that has a Jesus statue that's in like every 2B2T clickbait thumbnail ever. However, this grief triggered a series of events that would ultimately save and change the server forever. You see, let's rewind a little bit to around the middle of 2015. At this time, the server's official website hadn't been up for months, as the server owner refused to fund it himself, as around that time he had made it clear that he was tired of running 2B2T, and so the server was only running from a monthly $90 donation that the players had to pay for. When players asked Housemaster to bring back the official 2B2T website, he told them that he would, but only if they paid for it. And so, a $250 donation goal was set up, which would take many months to be filled. However, once it had been completed, weeks went by without any response from the server owner. This was because $250 would only be enough to host the server. It would never be enough to pay someone to create the actual website. Therefore, players iTristan and Clyde took it upon themselves to code the website themselves and send it to House so he could host it. However, being that it was Tristan and Clyde who provided the website, I'm sure it doesn't come to much surprise to any of you that, of course, it was fucking backdoored. But I'm sure a lot of you will be wondering, hasn't Housemaster been fucked over by iTristan before by using a plugin Tristan made for him? And yeah, you would be right. But you gotta remember that Housemaster wasn't in control of the server anymore, apparently, as it was still this so-called anonymous friend, which a lot of people suspect to be George Bush 420. Therefore, George was more than happy to use Tristan's website, which he then hosted on the same hardware that he hosted the server on, instantly giving Tristan the ability to view all player.dat files and server handshakes, which allowed them to spoof a login from George Bush's account. With this account, Tristan was able to use World Edit at his base and spawn in illegal items like 32Ks, pig spawners, bedrock, end portal frames, and more. This would have all gone unnoticed by the 2B2T community. However, this is where ImpSpace comes in. You see, iTristan used to be very good friends with a player named Jared2013, and in a Skype DM, Tristan accidentally leaked the codes of ImpSpace directly to Jared by posting a wrong screenshot. Since they were friends at the time, Jared didn't go after the cords, however, he made sure to save them in case things ever went south, and it's 2B2T, so of course they did. I asked Jared what went wrong with him and Tristan, but he told me he couldn't remember, so all I can really say is that they had a falling out. And so, Jared went out and griefed ImpSpace, which actually took many days to fully grief. In the process, he killed a few of the members and stole loads of artifacts from the base. The people at ImpSpace weren't too happy about this because, you know, they kinda liked their base that they'd spent years working on, and so I'm sure you wouldn't believe his luck when iTristan got coordinates to Jared's personal stash. This wasn't a normal stash though, because in this stash, Jared kept all his rare books and artifacts and illegal items from his time on 2B2T. Among these books, he found Jared's personal book diary that Jared had been writing since 2015. To get back at Jared, the people at ImpSpace decided to not only blow up the stash, but to make the contents of Jared's diary completely public. And FitMC of all people actually made a video reading the diary back in the day, however, that was deleted years ago. You can still view the book though, and I'll drop a link to where you can read it in the description, it's pretty funny. Anyway, Jared was kinda triggered that a bunch of his personal shit had just been leaked, and so he decided to take out his anger on iTristan by leaking a bunch of files on Tristan's computer, which included well downloads of 3 bases. Of course, it didn't take long for people to decide that they wanted to visit these bases to either just check them out or straight up grief them. However, when players arrived to one of the bases, they realized that something suspicious was going on, as not only did they find things like barrier blocks and other illegals, which wouldn't have been able to be spawned in previous backdoors, but they also found clearly world edited in structures that only someone with an OP account could create. This instantly made the player base unsettled, and many people instantly took a break from the server as they didn't want to be online whilst an obvious backdoor was going on. This is the day that FitMC refers to as the day 2B2T almost died, when in reality it didn't almost die because most of the players didn't just straight up quit, but the majority of people didn't feel safe being online at that moment in time. This event was what prompted a player named YSJ to make a Reddit post on r/Minecraft. Sadly, this post has been lost, but if anyone has any archived links for it, then please hit me up on Discord, which you can find by joining my Discord server in the description. Quick plug, please join my Discord server, I'm trying to hit 500 members, and I ping everyone when I stream or upload, so yeah. Anyway, this Reddit post is supposedly how the Camping Russia found out about 2B2T, and so finally, we have made it to the Russia War. Okay, so here's the rundown. Big YouTuber Camping Russia makes a video on 2B2T, with its main selling point being the fact that it's the oldest server in Minecraft. Which it isn't, by the way. The oldest server in Minecraft is actually called nerds.nu, and there is an IP if you want to check it out, I guess. Anyway, all you need to know is that 1 minute, the server has like 5 to 10 players online. The next minute, the server is 200 players online, so yeah. As you can imagine, Spawn must have been completely clusterfucked of new fags. But the thing is, guys, imagine the 2B2T storyline up to this point as something like a tree, the trunk being time and the branches being different groups and stories. Well, if the storyline up until this point has been a tree, then imagine the storyline from the point forward as, I don't know, the fucking Amazon rainforest or some shit. So, in order to try and stay as accurate as possible, I'm not gonna go into much detail about the less important events as that will take way too long and there's just way too much to get wrong since I only joined in May 2018, therefore everything up until then is going off other people's experiences and a lot of group drama can be heavily biased, so please bear that in mind. But without further ado, let's get going. Okay, so it's June 2016, Russia makes video on a server, then lots of new fags join server. Since the server hardware obviously wasn't made for this, the server experienced a shit ton of lag and crashes. Therefore, Housemaster put the server on a temporary map whilst he upgraded the hardware and made the queue. On this temp map is where the players FitMC and BubbaJ raided a Russia spawn base, and they killed like 40 people or something, which is kind of insane, and was basically when Team Veteran was first organised by Fit and a bunch of other old dudes to get rid of new fags. Once the server was back on its normal map, they killed a bunch of people at spawn, made a fat lava wall circling spawn 500 blocks on each axis, used FitMC to get them publicity, which is really effective as Russia made like an entire video on how Team Veteran's bad and shit when in reality it was obviously all just a bunch of roleplay to get content and money for both parties. However, it was fun for Russia's fans as they were all kids and didn't know better, and it was fun for the old players as it meant they had an easy means of killing new fags and they had veteran queue at the time anyway, so they really didn't have anything to lose. Either way, it was a win-win. The war went along pretty well, I guess. Russia made some paradise base and like a week later the veterans destroyed it. Then there were these other guys called the Resistance who originally claimed to support Russia but then like didn't, so I don't fucking know, it's weird. And all they really did was blow the shit out of the Valley of Wheat for some reason. Oh yeah, there was also this massive battle between the Russians and the veterans at spawn, but then other teams like the Resistance and a team called the Peacekeepers joined in, and at the end of the whole thing, Fit and Russia had their whole stunt about their duel, which I don't know, it's up for you all to decide whether you think that's genuine, if that was genuine or completely staged. I ain't gonna go over there because I already made a video talking about this, which got taken down after a bunch of new fags mass reported it, and okay, that was the Russia War summarized into like 300 words. You're welcome. So after the Russia war was officially over, the 2B2T player base split up into a copious amount of different new and existing factions slash teams. Most of these were to be forgotten within weeks, however, some are still present to this day and hopefully we'll cover at least a decent amount of them. Whilst the player base was rapidly decreasing due to the absence of YouTubers, a player named the Dark Emperor got bored of basing alone and decided to found a group which he called the Imperium. At the time, the group was solely created to become a building team, and to the Dark Emperor's surprise, the group started gaining members very quickly. This led him to set up the group's first ever base, called Arrowhead, so he could get an idea as to who was and wasn't trusted. Around this time is when the infamous Bedrock Coordinate exploit was first publicly used, which is where the common phrase, "I recognise that Bedrock, see you soon," comes from. Also, just a quick side note for any of you new players out there watching, never, ever say, "I recognise that something, see you soon," okay? The joke died in 2017, and I don't mean to be rude, but it's really cringy and tells people that you're obviously a fit fag, so please, I'm sure many of my fellow active 2BGT viewers can agree with me, just don't say it. Anyway, I digress. So this exploit was first publicly used to track down and destroy the pretty famous base Fitlantis, which was basically FitMC's biggest solo base at the time, and in one of the videos he made at the base he showed Bedrock, which of course he thought was fine at the time and so did everyone else, but we now know that your coordinates can be found from any viewable Bedrock you show in a picture or video. When the coordinates were first leaked, there was some massive PvP battle there between people who turned up that didn't like each other, and yeah, that's where terrain exploiting was first born, I guess. Along with the Imperium being founded in December of 2016, another notable group was also started by a player named Burnsy, called the Nether Highway Expedition Group, which aimed to dig a tunnel all the way to the Positive X world border in the Nether, which was finally completed in March of 2017, and speaking of 2017, that's what we're gonna get onto now. So, in January, the group Voco, which I mentioned earlier, also ended their quote-unquote first phase, which basically means the group went really inactive, and so to save the group from officially dying, the owner, called Coltsnid, announced that Voco was just dormant and preparing for phase 2, which officially started in May of the same year. In February, a player named Hermetic Clock decided to found a group based off of the same principles as the real-life secret society, the Freemasons. He called this group the Spawn Masons and ran it as a very exclusive group for builders that wanted to team up, and to this day they're still renowned for their awesome builds and structures. He created the team after his world-famous spawn base was griefed, and a battle broke out there between the griefers, which is known by some to be the third largest PvP battle ever. The group was different to other 2B2T factions in the sense that Hermetic Lock tried to make it more integrated into the actual game. He did this by hosting the weekly meetings in small bases called lodges, which they would then grief themselves, just like most of the other stuff they build. The next month, another major group that still exists today was founded, created by the Grand Lotus in February of 2017. The group called Highland was focused less on building and more on becoming a large community of people that just wanted to chill with each other. Eventually, this format started to attract mostly spawn fags and PvPers, and that is what the group is still most known for to today, as they still hold a very large presence at spawn. Oh yeah, the 2B2T logo also changed during this month to what it is today, so that's cool, I guess. What's not so cool, however, is that around this time, a player named Kino Runner, or just Kino for short, decided to take it upon himself to single-handedly piss off the majority of the 2B2T player base at the time. He did this by being the first to do the now common exploit of resetting all the maps on the server. Whilst nowadays it's something we all, especially map artists, sadly accept as being commonplace, back in March 2017 this had never been seen before, and therefore the player base were pretty outraged. It even got to the point where there was like a week-long protest in chat where several people would constantly spam lovely family-friendly phrases such as "Kino is a faggot" and "send Kino to ISIS." Shortly after this, however, a new donkey dupe was leaked to the public, and so the Jewishness of us 2B2T players took over, and everyone soon forgot it ever happened. So yeah, this just goes to show on 2B2T, whatever you do, within a week, nobody will give a shit. Anyways, a player called Frickin did a bad when he discovered that if you slash kill yourself whilst on a pig in the Nether, the server would end up crashing because Minecraft has spaghetti code. Needless to say, he abused the fuck out of this for a good month until it was finally patched by Paper Spigger after House introducing AAC anti-cheat to the server. In fact, slash kill was actually disabled for around a week, which is what started the whole meme of insert random thing here has been disabled due to an exploit. 4 days later though, finally some good news hit the server when Burnsy and his team, we mentioned earlier, the Highway Expedition Group, finally reached the world border after several months of digging. What lay at the end was a really cool surprise as they found signs placed beyond the border from both Pyrobyte and iTristan, which had never been seen before. They also found a Minecraft version of the book Minecamp, which had been created and left there by iTristan, along with a 32k, which were incredibly rare at the time. At the world border, the group got together and created a base called Point Nemo, which is a reference for the point in the real world which is furthest away from any land. This base took shape within a few days. However, less than a week after its creation, grief has sadly arrived there and the base was therefore completely destroyed. Nevertheless, the entire operation was considered an absolute success and the group went on to found the base Point Dory just a few days after, which lasted 2 months and is often considered up there with some of the biggest, most impressive bases ever publicly shown on 2b2t. It got griefed after one of the members, XXQ, got into a conflict with his base mates and decided to leak the base coordinates to the public, which of course led to the base being griefed by Bubba J and Nordic93. Shortly after this, it had been 1 year since Russia first joined the server and the player base had a huge shitpost festival to celebrate. This mainly consisted of people shouting racist shit in chat and this guy on the subreddit even blew up a mountain at his base. I know right, it's insane. However, fun and festivities can only last so long on 2b2t and so, the very next day, everything went back to normal. After this, a group called the Peacekeepers, which started during the war, decided to get mad at the spawn masons for no apparent reason and killed a bunch of the masons at spawn. The masons went on to do shit all about it and kinda just pretended the peacekeepers didn't exist, which is fair enough I guess. Oh yeah, and then the highway digging group after a few months finally reached the Z positive border, which would be the second highway ever to get the world border treatment. However, it along with most highways now are overshadowed by the famous X positive as players consider that the OG axis. Around this time, the Minecraft version 1.12 would be released and 2b2t was put onto a temp map until the server itself was ready to update. This update in game versions didn't affect the server all that much as most of the update was focused on new building material and quality of life improvements. However, what came along with this update marked the beginning of a series of common occurrences that every 2b2t player knows all too well to this day. This being Housemaster's retarded patches. Whilst whether or not you agree with the way in which Housemaster deals with illegal items is a completely different topic which would need a video of its own. Let's just say whenever Housemaster patches something like this, the community is usually not too happy to say the least. In this case, Housemaster patched all illegal items from the period, for example player heads, pig spawners and enchanted glass, would all be reverted when opened in the shulker box, whilst before the update players could just place them freely wherever they wanted. Although illegals were not as widespread as they are now, a lot of players back then were left annoyed that their illegal slash collectible items had been deleted. Not only this, but House had also messed up the patch and accidentally patched vanilla things like sharpness axes, if you care about that, and spawners in dungeons. But then the 2b2t community got its revenge. A player named Kino Rana, who we mentioned earlier, leaked a dupe called the Crafting Book dupe, which was not only really efficient to do, but also perfectly accessible for new players and anyone to partake in. The dupe involved dropping items whilst also spamming a crafting recipe within the crafting book. A glitch would happen where you'd pick up the item instantly and then the item would instantly stack to 64. This wasn't just limited to some items however, the method would also work to stack totems, armor, tools and potions which could be worn, used and consumed just like regular items. Although the dupe was patched by Housemaster just 8 hours after it got leaked, the damage had already been done and this is the day that many players mark as being the beginning of a series of dupes which would completely destroy the server's economy for years to come. After this, not too much happened for the next couple of months. The only thing worth noting is the whole drama between the builders of Summermelon and FitMC, which apparently goes along the lines of some guy called JD Dinger, who we now know to be a player named Toma54660, leaked the chords of FitMC's streaming bass, Rocket Town. Then, a player named Big Don, who based at Rocket Town, got mad that his bass got leaked, and so he gave the chords to a bass he had been invited to fit. This bass was called Summer Melon, and FitMC made a video griefing it where he claims that the builders of Summer Melon were the same people that leaked his bass. However, many people have come to believe that this is BS, since JD Dinger never actually bassed or had chords to Summer Melon, and so many have come to the consensus that Fit was just angry that his bass was destroyed and just decided to grief Summer Melon randomly out of rage and for an excuse to make a video. But I don't know, it's complicated, and again, a topic for another video. So now, let's move on to September of 2017. After the summer of 2017, the player base received a not completely welcome boost in new players, after a Spanish YouTuber by the name of ElrichMC made a short video on the server, which was the first time something like this had ever happened since Russia in 2016. This of course made the player base very paranoid, as in his video, ElrichMC stated that if his video were to get 250,000 views, then he would potentially start a series. The video would go on to garner over 300,000 views. However, he later stated in a Twitch stream that he wouldn't be returning to 2B2T due to the racism on the server. During this time, Project Obsidian Sky was completed, which involved building an obsidian ceiling over spawn, 500 blocks in each direction. Whilst in modern times, a structure of this size isn't even worth mentioning anymore, as it just doesn't compare to some of the shit the playerbase has done recently. Back then, it was considered a massive accomplishment, and to this day, the roof is still kept up and used by new players and active players alike. However, September wasn't all fun and games, as right at the end of the month, Housemaster would go on to completely disable Elytras from being used. This was mostly due to the immense lag that players would create by Elytra flying into unloaded chunks, which was just too much for the server to handle. The infamous message, "Elytras are temporarily disabled due to an exploit," would be seen by all players on the tab menu for almost the next 2 years. To add insult to injury, right after the disabling of Elytras, Housemaster would go on to completely remove veteran queue. This was due mostly to the fact that old players who had the queue were just selling their accounts for hundreds of dollars. However, you could also argue that the server was at a low enough point in player numbers at the time that veteran queue was no longer needed to be able to properly play the server. Either way, the community was pretty pissed off. And when the 2B2T community is annoyed, do they either A, write polite letters of complaint, explaining to the server admin why they think he is in the wrong, or B, decide to bot the server to shit, basically making it unplayable in an attempt to reason with Housemaster? Yeah, I think it's pretty obvious which route players went down this time, so let's move on, I guess. Alright, so now it's midway through December, and the two biggest groups on the server, Imperium and the Vortex Coalition, decide to say bye-bye to their old truce when the owner of Voco, Coltsnid, started saying mean things in 2B2T chat about the leader of Imperium, the Dark Emperor. Then the two groups killed each other's members a little bit, griefed each other's bases a little bit, and they were like, fuck it, let's be friends again, and so they buried their hostilities under a huge mountain of foreshadowing. And yeah, happy new year lads, it's now 2018, and in my opinion, this was the best ever year for 2B2T. Why, you might ask? Well, because it's when I joined, obviously. I'm kidding, it was actually a pretty dead year, but anyway, let's get to it. So this year started when a player named Retronaut X decided to do a big rebranding of his previously small group called Team Inferno. This was because during the Vopirium War, which we just talked about, Team Inferno decided to side with Voco, and in return, got completely anal fucked by Imperium. However, even once Voco and Imperium had settled their differences, Imperium decided to continue going after Team Inferno even more, as they realized how easily it would be to inside the group due to their poor leadership. And so, throughout Infrared's lifespan, Imperium would constantly keep them on their toes by griefing their bases and turning their higher-ups against each other. This, coupled with the fact that Retronaut's co-leader quit Team Inferno, the group was remade as Team Infrared. However, not much changed in terms of the group's actual structure. This is also around the time when Imperium tried to create a massive group alliance on the server, called the United Group Embassy. They had tried this before and it failed, however, this time it was going to be different, as now any group could join. The main purpose of the United Group Embassy, or UGE for short, was to have a space where any team that wanted could group up with many other teams for either protection or just to participate in cool group projects. However, due to this alliance being run by Imperium, Team Infrared took an instant disliking to the idea and set out to try and completely wipe the UGE off the face of 2BTT. This sounds like a good idea, right? And it was at first. Retronaut X successfully managed to get into the UGE and therefore receive coordinates to the UGE's first ever base, named the First Physical Embassy, which of course they instantly griefed. What they didn't take into account, however, was that as well as Imperium disliking them even more, now every one of the 14 teams inside the UGE also disliked them. So yeah, I think you can kinda tell what's gonna happen from here. Even after they allied with the notorious PvP group Highland, they were just too overwhelmed with insiders and internal conflicts that it was only a matter of time until their main base slash HQ was finally destroyed. The destruction of their main base was what put the nail into the coffin for them, and the group finally disbanded on August 26th of 2018. As for the UGE, they would go on to make two more embassy bases, which would eventually both get leaked and destroyed. The second was destroyed by its own members after an uninvited player, House One, showed up with not much explanation, although he had stated that he had been instructed by Voco not to grief it or whatever. And the third was leaked by the Grand Lotus, the founder of Highland, as sort of a revenge move to get back at some of the UGE members who were making fun of him. On April 3rd, 2018, whilst 2B2T was still on its April Fool's temp map for the year, a big Minecraft YouTuber by the name of AntVenom finally uploads a long-awaited video onto his channel about 2B2T. He had confirmed this video was coming the day before, and so good old Incursion Boy Sato86 had already begun preparations for what would now be 2B2T's sixth incursion. A dedicated Discord server was ready, and the link had begun to spread like wildfire within the 2B2T community. This incursion in practice was no more different than any others, however, for some reason, this was the last time an incursion of this sort would actually work on 2B2T. In my opinion, this is because nowadays the community has a lot less to lose, as Q is normally anywhere from 800 to 1500 anyway. However, before AntVenom made his video, Q was sitting regularly at around 20, so you could say that people fought hard in the 6th incursion due to the fear of needing to pay for priority queue. However, I don't really know. I have a full video on what happened to incursions that I made about half a year ago, so I recommend that if you want to learn more about the whole incursion thing, watch that. Anyway, as I was saying, this new incursion didn't really differ from the usual ones. However, it was pretty cool, as it was this incursion which gave birth to the construction of the famous 1k perimeter obsidian wall, which for those of you that don't know, was a single layer obsidian wall which was built all the way up from bedrock to height limit. This was the first time anything to this scale was built, and it was also where the hilariously funny and not overused meme "Slave Labor" came from, as to get some obsidian, some players would force new players to mine ender chests for them, as obviously when you mine an ender chest, it drops 8 obsidian back. Alongside this, the incursion also had a PvP regiment which would protect the builders of the wall from any opposing players and also regularly patrol spawn to make sure as little new fags or ants, which is what they referred to at the time, made out of spawn. This worked pretty effectively, as although when AntVenom's video first came out, you could see upwards of 300 players in queue, which is basically nothing by today's standards, it didn't take long for queue number to get lower and lower over time again. However, just when everything was settling down again, the insanely big YouTuber Popular MMOs was actually spotted as spawn online for a few hours. Luckily, when asked in-game if he was going to make a video on the server, he responded with a clear no, which led the playerbase sigh a sigh of relief, as a 10 million subscriber YouTuber joining could have potentially spelt death for the entire server. The incursion officially ended on the 3rd of May 2018 and was seen mostly as a success. However, at the beginning of the same month, a base was griefed by Jared 2013, and then the next day, another base was griefed by Jared 2013, then the next day, another base got wrecked. You can see where this is going, and it wasn't just a couple of bases that got griefed by him, because somehow he managed to grief a base every single day of the month. And 31 bases is a shit ton of bases to get griefed by one player in such a short span of time, and so everyone on the server, especially builders, had one question on their minds. How was Jared able to obtain so many bases? Many people were terrified it was a backdoor of some sort, or that Jared had managed to hack into certain builders' accounts in order to obtain bases. There were even fears that there was some kind of exploit involving the reverse engineering of maps, and so the map artist community of 2B2T called for a server-wide map reset in order to safeguard all bases that had map arts at them. To this day, nobody really knows exactly how Jared was able to get so many base coordinates. However, the most common theory is the fact that he had access to the exploit, which allows you to see newly generated chunks, and in turn, follow paths players have generated through the new terrain, which wasn't public in many clients like it is today. There was also the theory that he had used the terrain exploit to reverse engineer coordinates from screenshots of terrain, which, again, at the time, wasn't all that common. And of course, there was also the good old-fashioned insiding, something Jared seems to be incredibly good at in this day and age. Whatever it was, it caused a massive fright and upstir in the community, as people felt unsafe being at their bases and even playing at all. At the end of the month, two of the biggest known bases in 2B2T's history were both destroyed, Block Game Mecha and the Bodecan. At first, everyone assumed Jared had once again been the one responsible, however, it actually wasn't Jared, it was a player named Beardler. So basically the way this Beardler guy got the cords to these bases is that he became good friends with the owners of the 2B2T Museum server at the time, which was basically a server which housed hundreds of 2B2T base world downloads and stuff. He became such good friends with them, in fact, that he managed to become a curator slash admin for the server itself, meaning he was able to help out with getting world downloads from players and uploading them onto the server. This position instantly gave him a lot of good clout, since the museum server and its admins were very well respected at the time, and so over the next couple of months, he was invited to both Block Game Mecha and Bodecan by current members of the bases, as he was seen as trustworthy and well respected. However, this is 2B2T, and you know that really cringy phase that like all the 2B2T YouTubers say, trust no one? Well, that might actually have some importance here, because Beardler arrived at the Bodecan. He then proceeded to steal all the collectible items like sign books, map arts and illegal items, all that stuff. He then whipped out his TNT and proceeded to blow the ever-living fuck out of the base to try and cover up that he'd stolen the items. And you know, he definitely could have gotten away with this. You see, the Bodecan was only 8,000 blocks away from the Axis, so it could have passed off as just a random player found it and griefed it. But Beardler clearly had room temperature levels of IQ, and so what did he do? He went straight to Block Game Mecha and again, stole all the shit and blew it up. Obviously, members of both bases were pissed and they wanted to find out who was responsible. Everyone suspected Beardler from the start, since the autist was, in both cases, the first person to report the bases as being griefed, and one of the newest players to have been invited to both of them. However, no concrete evidence was formed until a player named Alpha Computer effectively hacked into the museum and went to the private world download of Block Game Mecha that Beardler had taken before he destroyed it. And what did he find in this world download? Beardler's inventory data at the time when the download was taken. And what was inside Beardler's inventory, you may ask? A bunch of the collectible shit that had just been stolen from the Bodecan. This instantly proved Beardler as guilty, and from that day on, the reputation of not only Beardler, but the museum server itself was completely destroyed. So yeah, that's the story of Beardler. Probably one of my favourite stories on 2B2T. I don't know why, it's just cool, I guess. Anyway, let's move on. And yay, it's dupe time. Looks like donkeys are the culprit again. Basically, if you used entity speed to ride on a horse faster than your chunks would load, you could basically make the game think that you just didn't exist, and so it would put the entity you're riding into the last chunk you loaded, whilst you would still be on your original donkey. Once the chunk would load, you would see the other donkey that the game spawned, Then you take all the items from the entity you were riding, then throw them in the hopper or whatever, then jump onto the other donkey and bam, that made no sense, but you just duped your items. Good job. Anyway, this dupe basically fucked the economy even more, and it was during this time when 2B2T item shops started getting set up, and players were basically able to obtain any item they wanted if they could pay the right price, which, by the way, whilst item shops nowadays sell shulkers for like 5 cents, back then you'd be getting a decent deal if someone sold you a shulker of something for like 3 bucks. This was also when 32k started cropping up, and when they were first sold, people would pay upwards of $100 for one singular sword, and this was before people actually knew you could wield them from a hopper. But yeah, this dupe lasted like the entire summer of 2018, and by the end of it, basically every single item in the game was worthless, including illegal items. So yeah, anyway, on the topic of the summer of 2018, I don't really think anything else major happened, so let's talk about a group called the Democratic Republic of 2B2T, and yeah, you heard that right. Someone actually tried to make a 2B2T group that relied on players voting on what the group should do and be, including who should be the leader. Yeah, sounds retarded, I know. But it was a funny idea at the time, and before you knew it, loads of people were trying to gather people's votes to become the so-called president. Funnily enough, I too actually ran for this position for the memes, and so did a lot of other people. However, shortly after the leader got elected, which was a player named Joey Coconut, I actually exposed to the group how basically everyone's votes were artificially inflated, and in about a week, the Discord just became a clusterfuck of shitposting, and eventually the server got deleted. So yeah, that's what happens when you try to unanarchy an anarchy server, I guess. Oh well, moving out from the summer and into September when all the kiddies were back to school again, the second YouTuber of the year decided to join the server and make a completely unannounced video. However, we'll get to that in a minute because, of course, this was also the month when the group The Backstreet Boys, or BSB for short, was founded. Created by a player named iMims and, of course, yours truly, the group was based off the premise of making specific German-themed work camps for new players. However, it quickly grew into a fully functioning group that still holds a lot of notoriety to this day due to its toxic nature and insiding and base griefing, coupled with its YouTube channel. Anyway, let's get to when this YouTuber joined, and this is a period I actually remember pretty well. In fact, when this guy made his video, I remember as soon as it was uploaded, my Discord was just spammed with notifications from at everyone's in all kinds of different servers, warning everyone that a big 1 mil sub YouTuber had joined. And this YouTuber was of course none other than Fuse3, or Fuse3 if you insist in speaking like our baguette-eating cousins on the other side of the pond, and yes, this YouTuber was actually fully French, and so was his audience. And obviously, before long, 2B2T chat was filled with new players talking French to one another, and let me tell you, us purebred English-speaking players were having none of it. And so, fueled by the anger that Q had just gotten a lot longer, and just general autism of course, a new incursion was born, and this was actually the first incursion that I went and partook in. Officially named the 7th incursion, as usual, it was started to try and get rid of the newly joined YouTuber fanbase, which, by the way, were called baguettes, because, you know, top class humour, you know, French baguettes, haha, banter. I actually remember the night that Fuse3 had uploaded his video, a dude called Henry had set up a Discord server for the new incursion, which had exploded with members as everyone wanted to take part and see what was going on. This Discord server was so big actually, to the point that there was fucking Ant Venom and FitMC both talking in a voice chat with like 50 other people, and my god, it was the biggest clusterfuck of people talking in a voice call I have probably ever seen. Anyway, after that, basically 75% of the people in the Discord were kicked by the owners for no apparent reason, including people like FitMC, as people thought that him encouraging drama between the Americans and the French so that he could grow his YouTube channel more was basically the opposite goal of what the incursion wanted to achieve. Fit actually got pretty mad at this, and this was kind of the last time he ever tried getting involved with the community, which is fair enough, I guess. But yeah, anyway, this whole incursion was basically just a mess. Like, at first, this Henry guy owned it, but then he got bored, so people voted, and Jared2013, of all people, became the new leader, which was fine, but then he started banning players that were generally just not helping and were just there to shitpost, which is fine on paper. But when you remember this is the 2B2T community we're talking about here, obviously everyone who was banned for stuff like shitposting got really mad and rallied up to form something called the Anti-Incursion. ran by the player Womanar Objects, or Wayo for short. The anti-incursion successfully managed to undo most of the incursion's progress and infiltrate its outpost with insiders. Then Jared got overthrown and another week or two went by and people realised things were just getting inactive, so the Discord officially announced that the incursion was over. And then there was a bunch of BS with other people trying to make new Discords, but overall it was pretty ass as far as incursions go. However, most people I've talked about speak very fondly about their time in the 7th incursion, and it allowed connections to be made across the server which spawned future groups such as the Infinity Incursion and helped smaller groups grow like my own team, the Backstreet Boys, at the time. The whole thing kinda concluded when Fuse3 made his last video on the server, wherein he had a highly scripted duel at Aurea City with Fit and he lost and bang, Frenchman gone. So yeah, from then on there, 2B2T basically kept rising in popularity, something we will get to very shortly. When all of this was going on, an exploit started to arise in the community, which had been kept quiet for almost a year by the players that had it. This was of course the exploit known as book banning, and the book dupe coming with it. So you may be wondering, how can someone be banned on 2B2T? It's anarchy, right? And yes, obviously you can't get banned from 2B2T, however, you can certainly be constantly kicked, effectively disabling you from joining. This player-made quote-unquote ban was done by filling Minecraft books with massive amounts of weird Unicode and Chinese characters. These books were then packed into a shulker which would be thrown to the person you were trying to ban. If your target picked up three or more of these shulkers, then opened a chest, ender chest, or shulker, he would get instantly disconnected from the server as his inventory effectively was containing too much data for the game to handle. This would happen every time he tried to log on, which would be even more frustrating for players without priority queue, as they wouldn't catch on to what had just happened until they had continuously gone through queue several times to no avail. The book dupe was kind of similar to this, wherein you would fill a chunk up with these books, which would overload the chunk and put it in kind of a glitch state, where you could make changes to the chunk and when the chunk would be reloaded, those changes would have reverted. Players used this to their benefit by filling up a chunk with gear and stuff they wanted to dupe, then overloading the chunk using the books, then take the gear out of the chunk and into another chunk, then reload the original chunk which would bring back the original gear, however the gear moved to the other chunk would still be there, which equals dupe. There was also an exploit involving these books, where if you killed another player with a single one of these books, then literally everyone in the server who had death messages are turned on, which is pretty much everyone by the way, would get kicked. This was obviously way too OP, and so the 2B2T admin literally had to straight up disable death messages whilst he worked on a patch. This exploit was so powerful and so easy to do, it was actually given the name of the Thanos Snap by the 2B2T community, as it would effectively kick basically everyone in the server back into queue. Ending off 2018 with a bang here, quite literally, the Backstreet Boys, which I mentioned earlier, finished a long brewing conflict with the group The Astral Order by griefing two of their bases and leading them to disband over the next couple of months due to lack of motivation from members and bad leadership. But The Astral Order wasn't the only group to go down in this time period. Infrared, which I mentioned earlier, decided to come back and rebrand themselves as Iridium, which lasted about 2 weeks until it faced the same fate as its predecessor. Also, the UGE, which we talked about from earlier on in the year, officially disbanded during this time. However, it had been inactive and dying out for the better part of half a year, and so yeah, that's 2018 just about wrapped up. Damn, I think that was the longest year to talk about so far, but don't worry, 2019's gonna be even juicier, so let's go. 2019 as a whole was basically a massive clusterfuck from the start, as even in January, shit was going down. The year kicked off when tensions between groups Highland and Imperium were at an all-time high, and over the course of a few days, there were several massive PvP battles at spawn, a couple of which were at the time some of the biggest battles that had ever happened on the server. I've tried to figure out who exactly ended up coming out on top from this conflict, however, everyone I've talked to in Imperium says that Imperium won, and everyone I've talked to in Highland says that Highlands won, but this is generally what I can come up with. So the way I see it, Imperium technically won the battles as they managed to kill all the Highland members, however, Highland members argue that they won because they made the Imperium PvPers run away and re-gear, and they were also vastly outnumbered by the Imperium. During all this, they also blew up a ton of each other's stashes and bases, and my group, the Backstreet Boys, actually somehow got caught up in one of the later battles, and I think at first we were fighting Highland with Imperium, but then Imperium started killing us and shit. I can't really remember, to be honest. It's literally just faction drama in a block game, and oh my god, look who came back. Wow, Infrared coming back from the dead again? Surely this time they're gonna do well. Surely they have failed so many times that they gotta become a big group now. Oh wait, no, they disbanded again not even 2 weeks after. Good job, Infrared! A few other groups also disbanded during this time, including a reborn Astral Order and a reborn Resistance. Then, near the end of February, yet another massive exploit was discovered and publicly used at spawn. This exploit was the now infamous chunk ban. Originally, a player named B. Flizer discovered that if the server sent you a packet of data over 2.2 megabytes, then it would automatically disconnect you and send you back to queue. He managed to take advantage of this limit by using a mod coded by a player called VA Demon to write signs with 1,536 characters on them, and then fill up a chunk full of them. This wouldn't kick you when you were building it, as there would only be small packets for extra every sign you placed. However, when another player, in most cases a new fag, would load the chunk, the server would flood him with one giant packet over the limit and instantly kick him. And they wouldn't be able to log back on, as seen in this clip, as every time they tried to log back in again, the server would send the exact same packet. B-Flizer used this to his advantage and built one of these sign chunks on the nether roof above 00, so anyone who came to spawn would instantly be banned. When these overpowered signs were eventually patched by Paper Spigot, players soon found out that the exact same thing could be achieved if you use banners or furnaces, or even enchanting tables, which all took a while to be finally patched. This exploit may have come at a very good time, however, as during this period of time, 2B2T was gaining massive popularity, with queues sometimes reaching into the 500 to 1000 range, which had been unheard of since the Russia war at the time. However, this time, it wasn't some big famous YouTuber joining, in fact, it was just YouTube in general. For some reason, the YouTube algorithm had decided to promote the ever-living shit out of 2B2T content. This was probably a result of Minecraft content in general spiking all of a sudden in popularity, due to big games like Fortnite dying out and leading their player bases to rediscover the old gem that many people had forgotten about. This surge in popularity led to channels like FitMC skyrocketing in subscriber count and putting previously smaller 2B2T YouTubers, Saucy1 and Baron Dome, into the spotlight. Due to the new queue numbers, many players discussed starting a new sort of incursion, and one player named Gambino took it upon himself to start one, which he called the 8th Incursion. However, nobody really took it seriously, and it basically just became a massive meme. During this time, another exploit was actually discovered by a player named Satisfaction, which effectively allowed a player to be invisible, invincible, and be able to travel over 500 blocks per second. This exploit was quite suitingly named the God Mode exploit, and he actually discovered it on accident when he was messing around with entity speed, and luckily, he was recording at the time it happened, so he was able to look back at how he did it. The exploit basically involved getting on a pig or a horse, then using entity speed to outrun the chunks loading, and then, sometimes if you were lucky, your entity would rubber band and make a duplicate of your entity, which you would be riding on. You would be able to ride this duped entity anywhere, whilst the original would just stay in the same spot, therefore tricking the game that you were just sitting still on the pig when, in reality, you could be flying down a highway at a million blocks an hour. This exploit was incredibly private at first, with Satisfaction only giving the method to his closest friends, one of his friends being a player named Paralusion, who developed the method further to perform the exploit more easily. Once they got bored with keeping it quiet, they went to spawn and start killing people with it. Then, two players called HouseVault and Steve3 saw what was going on at spawn and wanted to perform it for themselves, and so they also figured out how to do it. In fact, they even managed to make a mod which allowed you to get into the God Mode state incredibly easily, so Satisfaction and Paralusion befriended them and essentially created what they called Team God Mode. And to cut a long story short, they basically kept getting more and more members into the group, and used the exploit to troll at spawn and to dupe, and till for some reason one of the people in Team God Mode called Finster decided to sell the method for one shulker of items. Yeah, I don't know, he was probably just trying to piss everyone off. Anyway, Team God Mode knew that it was only a matter of time before the method would go public, and so they created a fake player which they called Slendy Beast to leak a backdoored version of the God Mode mod. People caught on pretty quickly, however, it did work and they managed to get quite a few bass chords with it. But then the method went public and Spawn was basically just a clusterfuck of invisible players trying to crystal each other, which was interesting to say the least. The exploit would never truly be patched, as there are still ways to do certain aspects of it to this day, however, it's nowhere near as overpowered as it once was. This exploit may have come at a very good time, however, as this was also the time when 2B2T would face its biggest ever spike in popularity for the time. This was, of course, triggered by the famous streamer Etika finding out about 2B2T and joining it on stream to tens of thousands of viewers, which, for most of the 2B2T player base, was just too much, and so finally, a new incursion was started. Although this time they didn't want to call it an incursion, as a lot of people thought that the word had basically lost its meaning for whatever reason, but yeah, it was called The Purge. But it was basically just a rebranded incursion. If you want to know more about this, then I actually made a video about The Purge a while ago, which you should watch if you want a more in-depth explanation on the whole thing. Within days of him joining, the server's queue had reached an all-time high for the time, and literally hundreds of new players were joining for the first time each day. The Purge quickly got to action, building lava walls around spawn, trapping nether portals, and also using book banning as a mass weapon for the first time on 2B2T. To try and get rid of some of the new players. The most effective method by far, however, was the Purge's use of lag machines. Through lagging the server to the point where it was practically unplayable, they managed to block Etika from getting any good gameplay on stream, as soon as Purge members would see that Etika was streaming, they would instantly turn on their lag machines in order to make it quite literally impossible for Etika to play. This resulted in basically 99% of his streams just being him waiting in queue and talking about his plans to take over the server. This, of course, made Etika's fanbase get bored of the whole 2B2T thing incredibly quickly, and by the beginning of June, the queue was already down to 400, which is a massive improvement for the 1500 queue numbers that were recorded just 2 weeks prior. Etika would stream 2B2T for the last time on June 2nd, 2019, and the Purge concluded as an absolute success just 2 weeks after. And as I'm sure basically everyone watching will know, just a week after that is when Etika would sadly take his own life after posting his own suicide note to YouTube, and sadly no, it wasn't so that he could build the 9 base on 2B2T, which, yup, some people actually believed at the time. Now, rewinding a little bit, in May of 2019, Jared held his second ever 31 Days 31 Griefs, where, just like the year before, he griefed one base every day for 31 days. This time it was a little different, as he made it a whole meme about bases getting dipped or whatever, and he didn't even grief some of the bases himself, he just posted the coordinates to the subreddit, but anyway, moving on. Although Etika had left the server forever, the effects of him joining would still carry forward to this day, as many YouTubers would find out about 2B2T from Etika and make videos of their own, contributing to the growth of the server's viewership base. Over the course of 2 months, many YouTubers were spotted on 2B2T. These included Private Fearless, Atlantic Craft, and even the Camping Rusher himself joined back for a short period of time. However, his new videos never gained any traction, so he promptly left again and faded into obscurity. During this period of increased activity, the server owner actually posted onto the Reddit a massive thread containing his future plans for the rest of the year. These included good things like patching illegal items like 32k sharpness swords, upping the player server cap, experimenting with updating the server and getting the server on some brand new hardware. However, it also announced some things that the playerbase weren't too happy about, like the patching of unbreakable items, updating to a different anti-cheat that would patch most things like Jesus and Step, and of course the main thing, patching entity speed, which was a massive deal to the server, as that was basically the best method by far for traveling the server's map at the time. Once entity speed was patched, players had to resort to using a different assortment of speed hacks, which were very glitchy and sometimes just disconnected you from the server for no apparent reason. However, not before long, the server owner actually re-enabled elytras for the first time in 2 years, which finally allowed players to fly all over the map, which was really new and cool at the time. This made spawn way easier to get around for geared players though, which also meant that basically all spawn bases that were somewhat hidden were griefed in a matter of weeks, as finding spawn bases in general was just way easier for griefers. The server owner also, for the first time ever, actually started another server that wasn't 2b2t. It was simply called the 2b2t test server, and he used it to test patches for different illegal items, and even tested running the server in 1.13, which was basically unplayable because of all the lag. This was a pretty cool idea, as it also took a lot of new fags away from the main server, as the test server didn't have a queue. However, even with this new test server taking some of the load from all these new players joining, queues for the main server rose and rose, which Jared 2013 decided to use as an opportunity to start the last ever proper incursion, which in this case was called the 8th incursion, and it actually went pretty well. Although the final goal of completely watercubing spawn was never achieved, it definitely showed that it was still possible that a non-meme incursion could be somewhat successful in modern day 2b2t. However, as time went on, people eventually got bored and Jared lost motivation to keep running it, and so he gave control to a very epic German player called Bucky Buckbuck, who actually converted the Discord into something he called the Infinity Incursion, which is supposedly meant to carry on the incursion's name as part of a more organized group rather than just a random get-together of players. To this day, they remain pretty active, and I recommend if you're just starting out on 2b2t and are looking for a good team, try giving them a go, as they seem pretty chill and fun to be around. Anyway, now it's around October 2019, and a group of players get together to try and finally do something about all these new players joining, and at this time, there was still a relatively easy method for book banning. Put two and two together, and voila, the book club was born. A team completely dedicated to book banning new players at spawn, lagging the server, and creating chunk burns. Through the use of automated book banning traps and a high member count, they managed to effectively book ban hundreds of new players from the server, with records showing anywhere from 400 to 700 accounts getting banned. The server admin, for obvious reasons, wasn't too fond about this, as it was basically losing him priority queue sales. And so, he took revenge by removing the priority queue from several of the members of the book club, including some people that were completely innocent. Which really begged the question, how did the server owner think to queue ban these four innocent players? This led many players to believe that the server owner might actually have had an account in the book club Discord to look for usernames of the top players to queue ban. This is all speculation, however, and of course nothing can be confirmed. Once book banning was finally patched, the book club had to figure out a new way to annoy the server owner, and this time they decided to do something called No Server November.
No Server November, that's what you say, you take down the server that we love to play. What will it accomplish? Nobody knows. The show housemaster and his cocaine nose explodes. Talk to someone who knows it's for the clout. The Minecraft pictures and pose is what it's all about. Why you fucking up the server, making it close just to satisfy overblown egos?
Which was essentially just them crashing the server at least once a day for every day of November. Once this was done, the team went inactive and split up into smaller groups like Team No Trees and Brown Men. Throughout November, a project was completed by the group Infinity Incursion, which was to build a massive obsidian logo above spawn, which was and still is the largest man-made structure on 2b2t other than the highways and the Southern Canal. The group, the Spawn Masons, saw this and thought to themselves, we ain't having this, let's do them one better, and used a network of AI-powered bots to build their own logo over spawn, which consisted of 28 million blocks of obsidian, which is definitely not something you would ever hear on any other server than 2b2t. This was also known by some to be called the Masonic Eclipse, as the gargantuan structure cut sunlight off from a good part of spawn, basically stopping any food or trees from growing without man-made light. When New Year's Eve came in 2019, a group called Brown Men, which was a splinter group of the book club, decided to celebrate in true 2b2t fashion by making a full reconstruction of 9/11 out of TNT and exploding it just in time for 2020, and yes lads, you heard that correctly. We're finally in 2020, and I massively appreciate anyone who has made it this far into the video, because I know it's probably less than 1% of you, so if you have made it this far, comment DigMC is the best 2b2t YouTuber down below to show your dedication, and I'll heart your comment. Also, I'm sure at this point everyone watching this far in has already subscribed, but if you haven't, then please do hit that subscribe button, along with turning on notifications and liking the video, because it really helps me in the YouTube algorithm, so yeah. Now that that's out of the way, let's get straight into 2020, and nothing really happened in January, so let's skip straight into February, where shit seriously hit the fan. Near the end of the month, a new exploit was discovered and slowly spread, which enabled whoever had access to it to quite literally log into 2b2t, or any server for that matter, as anyone they pleased. A massive ordeal started when some players found themselves logging into 2b2t at spawn with their ender chests wiped. At first, people suspected that the server owner had messed up and accidentally reset or corrupted certain players' player data. However, when people emailed the owner, he provided proof to some people that their accounts had actually been logged into for a short period of time. This obviously made the entire community shit themselves, as if you were logged out at your base, someone could easily enough just log into your account without knowing the email and password and instantly just blow up all your shit. This, of course, is really not that great on a server like 2b2t, so the server owner was really quick to get in contact with Mojang so that they could patch the bug that was causing this exploit. But sadly, the damage had already been done. People who had the exploit targeted well-known players, and people that were likely to be at big bases, and several massive bases were destroyed as a result of this. The biggest one so far being Moo Megabase, which had been kept quiet since 2017, and here's a screenshot of it here, it's fucking massive. They also went on sprees logging into loads of people's accounts just to wipe their ender chests and kill them back to spawn. However, it wasn't all bad during this period of time because 2b2t saw its first ever wedding. Since everyone was at home due to the whole Ching Chong Boomer remover thing, sadly the newly engaged players Big Girl XOXO and Karay Kitty had their in real life wedding abruptly cancelled, and so they thought, hey, in the meantime, let's celebrate our engagement by hosting our very own pretend wedding on 2b2t, you know, just as every normal couple would do. Why they chose 2b2t over quite literally any other Minecraft server is beyond me, however, it does go to show that even after 9.5 years of wars, chaos, betrayals, invasions, toxicity, griefing, and doxing, that even a server like 2b2t can have its very own happy ending. Yeah, who am I kidding? It was blown up in like 5 minutes, don't worry about it.